So, very good evening to all our viewers on this wonderful Sunday evening. Today, indeed, we have a very interesting topic and a very renowned speaker. The topic for today's webinar is reverse shoulder arthroplasty. And the faculty for today is Professor Dr. Mohan Desai. Dr. Mohan Desai has been a professor of orthopedics at the State GS Medical College and KM Hospital since the past 10 years. His special interest is in hip, knee, and shoulder arthroplasty. He has been a vice president of the Bombay Orthopedic Society. He has been a faculty for over 200 courses and conferences in India and the world over on arthroplasty. He's a reviewer in the International Journal of Shoulder Surgery and also an invited editorial board member of the Journal of Postgraduate Medicine. So without much delay, may I now invite Professor Dr. Mohan Desai to present this webinar on reverse shoulder arthroplasty. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Swapnil, for inviting me. It is indeed a pleasure to talk on this reverse shoulder replacement. And the typical indication for reverse shoulder is cuff tear arthropathy. Here on the left side, you can see the superior migration of the humeral head. Acromio-humeral distance is significantly reduced. There is almost acetabularization of the acromion. The patient has difficulty in active elevation, which is a combination of abduction and forward flexion of the upper limb associated with the pain. Typically, these are done in elderly individuals more than 75 years. As we grow in our confidence in performing this reverse shoulder, we are extending these indications to massive rotator cuff tears without arthropathy. A case like this, where there is a superior escape, patient is unable to elevate the arm, and that is associated with the pain. So in short, cuff tear arthropathy, pseudo paralysis, failed cuff surgery, anterosuperior escape, tuberosity malunion, acute shoulder fractures in elderly more than 75 years, where one would like to have one-time surgery, and the function with the reverse shoulder may be slightly better than hemiarthroplasty with the possibility of malunion or non-union of the tuberosities and in a tumor scenario. So in short, whenever there is a loss of biomechanical fulcrum for elevation, this may be because of the irreparable loss of rotator cuff or severe malposition of the tuberosities. A case like this, where painful failed hemiarthroplasty, the design is non-anatomical, it has ripped off the rotator cuff, and this would need reverse shoulder. Similar case, and again, it was converted to a reverse shoulder. You can see the function here at 2 months. Failed resurfacing, no cuff, indication for reverse shoulder. Failed fixation like this, tuberosity is non-union. There is no option because conversion of this to hemi wouldn't work that well. Failed tuberosities, fixation associated with the arthritis, again an indication. Failed infected hemiarthroplasty, where one would need two-stage revision, but the deltoid, intact deltoid, is a prerequisite for performing reverse shoulder. Sometimes it can be a primary option in elderly, in severely comminuted fracture, where one can perform primary reverse shoulder in patient more than 75 years. Tuberosities malunion is very common, as described by Pascal Bolu. It is as high as 50%. It may be because of the initial tuberosity malposition or tuberosity detachment and migration, and it is often associated with poor outcome. The reasons for tuberosity malunion may be prosthetic malposition, excessive height, retroversion. It may be poor prosthetic design, poor position of the greater tuberosity, or there may be osteoporosis where the tuberosity fixation may fail. The contraindication to reverse shoulder is, of course, active infection, non-functioning deltoid, It can work with the absent rotator cuff, but deltoid has to be intact. Insufficient glenoid bone stock or quality. Younger patient is a relative contraindication. And of course, the neuropathic joint. Take, for example, a case like this. This is a neuropathic joint. You can see total resorption of the humeral head, fragmentation of the glenoid, and this was secondary to leprous neuritis. And this, that's a contraindication. Contraindication or reverse is no indication. The patient may have on the x-ray superior migration, but functionally minimally disabled, almost no pain, and can do day-to-day activity. This, we don't treat the x-rays. There is a Hamada's classification for rotator cuff arthropathy from stage 1 to stage 5. And stage 4 to 5 are rotator cuff arthritis, which are classical indication for performing reverse shoulder. Stage 1, 2, and 3 are massive rotator cuff tears without arthritis. Biomechanically, if you see the deltoid, Kapanji has divided this deltoid into 7 groups, 1 to 7. And in normal shoulder, only group 2 and group 3 take part actively in active elevation, which is a combination of forward flexion and abduction. However, when we perform reverse shoulder, there is a medialization of the center of rotation, and we have recruitment of more anterior groups and posterior groups, which now perform active elevation of the shoulder instead of just doing forward flexion or extension. There is distalization of the deltoid insertion and lateralization, and distalization of 1 centimeter of deltoid insertion can increase the deltoid efficiency by as much as additional 30%. Previously, there were attempts to form or design reverse shoulder, but they were with the small balls, constrained designs, and they obviously had less movement. The Gramont's design typically has a big ball, lesser constraint or a semi-constraint, and it has a larger range of movement. This is a precursor of modern day reverse Gramont's prosthesis, which was called trompet prosthesis, and it worked due to medialization of center of rotation. So if you see the deltoid elevation torque, which is a product of, on the left side, if you see, which is L1 multiplied by F1, in a rotator cuff deficient shoulders, this is far less. There is superior migration of the humeral head. On the other hand, on the right side, you can see the reverse shoulder, where the L2 and F2 are increased. This is due to the medialization of the lowered center of rotation. The deltoid elevation torque is far better in reverse shoulder. Not only that, besides this, there are advantages of medializing the center of rotation like this. There are less shear forces acting on the glenoid, which would mean there are less chances of glenoid loosening. The approach to the reverse shoulder can be deltoid splitting or superior, superolateral approach or McKenzie's approach. The other approach is most popular or commonly performed deltopectoral approach. The steps are humeral preparation first, then we go on to the glenoid preparation, then we have a flat base plate which is uncemented, biologically coated from outside, which is in contact with the glenoid, which is known as a metaglen. On the metaglen, the glenosphere, which is a ball or a sphere, is implanted. And then we go on to the humeral cell implantation and trial reduction, and then final prosthesis. There are technical tips as regards humeral version, glenoid placement, glenoid version and the tilt, and the screw placement, especially on the glenoid side. So the placement of the glenoid typically is perpendicular to the plane of the glenoid as described by Mattson. However, in the deformed glenoids, there are erosion and this may not be possible. And we have alternate center line or scapular spine line, which is perpendicular to the scapular spine. There is a nice article by Christian Gerber way back in 2010 and describes the stability of the prosthesis or of the joint, your shoulder, with respect to the version of the components. Now we should remember, largely it is dependent on the concave part of the component. In the reverse shoulder, it is humerus. In total shoulder, it is glenoid, which is concave. So the glenoid version, which is now the sphere, because it has a larger contact, can be from 10 degree retroversion to 20 degree anteroversion, and it still doesn't affect the stability. This is advantageous because we have lot of leeway in placement of the glenoid. Now we can concentrate on achieving the best bone stock and placement of our screws and the pegs in the best bone stock there. So you can change the glenoid version accordingly. However, we should avoid more than 10 degree of retroversion. Intrinsic stability depends more on the humeral version, which is extremely crucial. If you have to gain the stability, we should give slightly less retroversion. There is a gain of more than 20% with each 10 degree anteversion of the humerus. Classic ground suggested that we should increase the humeral retroversion, and he advised 30 degree of retroversion. This could, because of this, one could achieve external rotation, but it is always at the cost of internal rotation. Internal rotation is sometimes important, especially on the left hand, for the perineal care. So nowadays, humeral component is placed not more than 20 degree retroversion. In fact, lesser the retroversion, better is the stability. The typical position in which the shoulder will dislocate, the reverse shoulder, would be adduction, extension, and external rotation. So if you give more retroversion, there will be more external rotation, and there would be susceptibility of that joint to dislocate, especially through deltopectoral approach. Screw placement is important. There are safe zones of Shishido and Kikuchi. They have suggested, especially if you have fixed angle base plates, the screw can superiorly cut through the bone, perforate the bone, and can endanger the suprascapular nerve. So nowadays, we prefer a variable angle screws and three column concepts in respect to the scapula have been described. These are the best bone stocks where one can place the screws. One is the red one is the base of the coracoid. The superior screw should be aimed at the base of the coracoid. The middle screws should be through the spine of the scapula. And third is scapular pillar, which has again good bone stock. The screw trajectory are typically angular, anterior superiorly, and anterior inferiorly. And typically, if you have fixed angle screws there, one can perforate the bone. So variable angle base plate is preferred. Similarly, glenosphere positions are also important. These should be placed in a such a manner that there should be minimal rocking, otherwise there would be glenoid loosening. Proper tension in the reverse shoulder is important, and it would come with the experience. It should be little hard to reduce and little hard to dislocate. It should not be too loose, not too tight, but just right. And the learning curve for reverse shoulder may be first 20 to 40 cases. If the deltoid is too loose, one, there is a risk for instability and dislocation. If deltoid is too tight, there may be a risk for acromial fracture and decreased range of movement. These are the results for survival of reverse shoulder. Typically, 91% at 5 years, to 91 to 95% at 8 years. And if you subdivide into different subgroups according to the diagnosis, the cochlear artery has the best survival. It has almost 95% survival at 10 years, whereas revision fracture sequelae or rheumatoid arthritis may have as low as 77% survival at 10 years. What do we expect after reverse shoulder? One should definitely get a pain relief. There is improvement in the function. There is increased range of the movement, increased ability to perform activities, improved quality of life, and return of independence. There is a nice paper in JBJS. And what do we expect? increased range of movement, especially forward flexion to almost to 105 degrees, abduction to almost more than 100 degrees, overhead abduction, and 95% satisfaction rate. This is one of our own cases, 8 months old, failed attempts at fixation, and the head is almost in the axillary fold, lying against the rib cage, and the surgery, initial surgery was abandoned, and then we converted this to a reverse shoulder. This was his 3D CT, and note that the head was lying next to the axillary artery. When we did it, did not even attempt to remove that head, we left it there. And this was his function. At 8 months, he was a taxi driver and he was back to his action. So very happy person. So a successful reverse shoulder can give really gratifying results. Another one, rotator cuff arthropathy. We have Hamada stage 5. Patient is retired, staff nurse, not able to do her day-to-day activity. And that was 3-year follow-up. Now we have a 10-year follow-up of her case now, done 10 years back. And we can see the function now. Abduction is almost overhead. So that is the function at which we are, to which we look forward to. And that's the external rotation in abduction. So she had other joints also involved, knees especially, and she was with the shoulder done, she was back to her action, back in her action, and she was independent. However, there are complications, and there is a big list of complications for the reverse shoulder. Infection, wound problems, excessive blood loss, injury to the nerve and blood vessels, failure of subscap repair, mechanical failure of the device, periprosthetic fracture, weakness, stiffness, subluxation or dislocation of the prosthesis, another surgery, and anesthetic risk. Scapular notching is supposed to be very common, and we need to strike a balance between stability and scapular notching. If we increase the angle, there is better stability. With 155 degree of humeral neck shaft angle, there is better stability. If you have smaller neck shaft angle, there is less potential for notching. If you have bigger angle, there is increased chance for notching. And this notching is graded into 1 to 4. The 4 grade is that the notching is so severe that it almost touches the central peg, and it may result in loosening of the glenoid component. The causes for notching may be micromovement of the screw or direct impingement of the lateral board of the scapula in the humeral cuff. And the reasons may be surgical reasons, anatomical, that is the morphology of the patient's scapula, the prosthetic design, or pathological. There may be erosion in the glenoid and resultant inclination of the glenoid. So you can see there is a grade 4 erosion there on the scapula secondary to the reverse shoulder here. Instability or dislocation, there are typical 4 eyes. Infection can stretch the capsule because of the pus, and it can distend the capsule and it can cause instability. This may be secondary to inadequate tensioning of the deltoid. Gramont labeled this as global decooptation. It may be because of the impingement. It may be because of the escaped tuberosity fragment or any other bone fragment or cement or so on and so forth, or incompetent or irreparable subscap approach. Especially one does through deltopectoral approach, the subscap is not repaired, the anterior door is open and the reverse shoulder can dislocate. So approach is important. There are 2 approaches, superolateral approach, where you make a window, and that's the window is typically superior, and you have deltopectoral approach, window is anterior, and if you don't close this window, that is the subscap, there is a high chance for dislocation. Typically in the literature, we have dislocation rate of superolateral related to superolateral incision are 0%, whereas deltopectoral incision is there are as high as 6 to 13%. This may almost 68% of the cases, the instability is related to inadequate soft tissue tensioning. Many have partial axillary nerve palsy and deltoid paralysis. In the late cases, it may be because of the mechanical liner failure or poly wear, or it may be because of the impinging heterotrophic ossification. And solution to these is obviously correcting the version, especially on the humeral side. But if there is no obvious solution, we have constant liners and liners with the height. So there are standard and more retentive liners which are available, where one can revise to these liners to give the stable shoulder. Glenoid loosening may be a problem in late cases. This may be because of the micro motion, and if the micro motion is more than 150 micrometers, there may not be bony ingrowth, but there may be fibrous tissue there, and the glenoid will eventually loosen up and come out. Infection is a dreaded complication, and it may require, it can lead to dislocation as well. It will require a two-stage procedure. Scapular spines fractures have been described, and they are classified into type 1, type 2, and type 3. So complication reduce after surgeon's experience, and they typically reduce after 40 cases. So that's the learning curve for the reverse shoulder. The success comes from good decisions. Good decisions come from experience, and experience comes from bad decisions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And that was indeed an excellent presentation. You've covered almost all the indications, all the complications, and all the conditions which may be present in a patient, and you have shown beautiful clinical examples. Now, we shall ask all our viewers who are going to watch this webinar to kindly put their questions in the comment section, and we would then try and answer them as these comments come. So I thank you a lot from my heart, and on the behalf of SICOT India and SICOT India Scholar Program, for taking time out and presenting this webinar. Thank you very much, sir.